Lord Jesus, we love you so much. Father, we thank you for the power that's in the Word of God. Father, I pray right now in Jesus' name that you would speak clearly, that you would speak loudly. Father, that you would give each woman here a personal, intimate word. Father, your word says that you are intimately acquainted with all of our ways. So, Father, right now you know what every woman in this room needs. And, Father, we just say with one voice, speak, Lord, because your daughters are listening. In Jesus' name, amen. Do you remember the scene in Fiddler on the Roof when Tevye was saying, well, on this hand, but on the other hand, but on this hand, but on the other hand. You know, theologians say that in the Bible there's something called divine contradictions, and I never really liked that phrase, but I understand what they're saying. But I just know that the Bible doesn't contradict itself, but there's something about the Bible that you get it on this hand, but on the other hand, you're left scratching your head. You know what I'm talking about? Am I the only person who does that? You know, things like you give to receive. If you want to be great, you got to be a servant. You know things like that. Well, tonight we're going to study one of those things because, let me tell you something, abundant life is free, but it's going to cost you something. Abundant life is absolutely and gloriously free, but it's going to cost you more than you could ever imagine. You know, when I was praying about what to speak about this fall, what Bible study to do, and the Lord said to me, well, what do you want to talk about? What do you want to teach on? And I said, well, I want to teach on joy and strength and power and your emotions and how to read your Bible and why you shouldn't worry and why you shouldn't give your husband the silent treatment and that you should never be lonely and that you should only be angry for 24 hours and no, well, actually 23 hours and 59 minutes, but who's counting? I just wanted to reteach all those things. And the Lord said, yeah, that's what I want you to teach on too. And I said, well, Lord, where is it? And he said, think, Carol, think. I gave you mine, think. And I realized it's all in the Psalms. All of those topics are in the Psalms. Every single one of the topics that we steer our ships by are found in the Psalms. We see joy and sorrow, victory and failure, death and life, power and weakness, all of those things are in the Psalms. Now, we've only got 3 weeks, and the Psalms has 150 chapters, right? So we're not going to make it to every single one. But I've strategically picked out 3 different teachings that I believe will give you strength to go on, that I believe will help you steer your ship through anything you go through. You know, just joy is really built on 4 things. It's built on the power of prayer, worship, teaching of the word, and friendship. And sisters, let me tell you something. If you've got those 4 things in your life, you can make it through anything. If you'll read your Bible, if you will worship with reckless abandon, and wasn't that worship tonight among the best worship we've ever been in? If you would get on your knees and pray, if you will have a good friend or two, you can make it through anything. You can make it through almost anything. Well, the book of Psalms addresses all those things. And Psalms, the main content and the theme of this book is praise, prayer, and worship. To make the book of Psalms personal, it poses these questions to us, even in the 21st century. Will you choose to worship when life is hard? Oh, that's a question we all have to answer. Will you worship when life is hard? Question number 2, will you sing even when you're lonely? Oh, that's a question we all have to answer. Will you praise the Lord regardless of what your heart is shouting? That's a question you have to answer. Will you pray when you're in the battle? Is he worthy of your worship or not? Those are some questions that you have to answer personally. The Psalms were written to encourage all kinds of people to worship the Lord. The Psalms encourage us to worship God under an open heaven like David did. It encourages us to worship the Lord when we're walking through the valley of the shadow of death. The Psalms encourage us to worship when we're on that brink of the pit of despair. You know the pit that David talks about? Will you worship in that place or not? Will you worship when you're in a cave hiding from an enemy? Will you worship the Lord? The Psalms were written to encourage all of us to worship the Lord when we're being pursued by a relentless and a vicious enemy. I don't know what your enemy is. For David, it was King Saul. King Saul was trying to assassinate David. Who's your enemy? My enemy has been different things. It's been infertility. It's been depression. It's been cancer. We all have an enemy that's relentlessly pursuing us. But in that place, just like David, we have to decide, will I worship or will I hide? I don't know about you, but I'm going to worship. I'm going to worship even when I'm being pursued. When you find yourself in deep need, you can find yourself in the Psalms. The Psalms is a book for anyone and everyone. It's for the sick, it's for the suffering, it's for the poor and the needy, it's for the prisoner and the exile and the person in danger and the persecuted. Psalms is a book for sinners. It's a book that tells of God's great mercy. Psalms is a book that's it's for the person who served God for their entire life. You can still find yourself in the Psalms. There's been no other book in the entire Bible that has meant more to the people of God since the time of David than the book of Psalms. Isn't that the truth? That's the truth. And let me tell you something else. There has been no other book in the entire Bible that unbelievers turn to like they do the Psalms when they're going through a hard time. Many people believe that David wrote the book of Psalms, and that's partially true. He did write a lot of it. But after he died, Solomon, his son, took over, and Solomon wrote some of the Psalms. Also, there were two worship leaders by the names of Ethan and Asaph who also wrote some of the Psalms. And surprise of all surprises, believe it or not, even Moses wrote some of the Psalms. Now, I call this Bible study Selah. That's how you say it, Angel and Monica. Selah, in case you're wondering. And that one word is used 71 times in the book of Psalms. Now that we know that Psalms was actually the hymn book of ancient Israel, that was the book they turned to when they wanted to worship. This word Selah is going to make sense to you. It's Psalms is a hymn book. You got it? Remember when you used to go to church, or maybe some of you still go to a church where you open that hymn book and sing, and you see the notes, and you see the chord progressions, and you see the stanzas, and you see the rest in a song, which means stop. Take a breath. This word Selah means stop, pause, take a breath, but it means more than that, and I'm so surprised Google didn't know this. My daughter Emily is not a very good driver, and everybody says, Emily, you are just not a good driver. You do so much so well, but please let somebody else drive. You know, I'm always praying for my grandbabies in the car with her, and it's got to be a family joke, and Boyce, the four-year-old, Boyce, you know Boyce. One day they were getting in the car and he said, Mom, do you want to know how to be a good driver? And she said, yes, I do. And he said, well, Mom, you put your hands at 10 and 4. I don't know what that means, but you put your hands at 10 and 4. And Mom, then you put it in gear, reverse if you're backing up, drive if you want to go forward. And then gently put your foot on the gas pedal. And she said, boys, how do you know that? And he said, I asked Siri. I said, Siri, how do you be a good driver? And Siri told me. Well, Google is sort of like that, but Google doesn't know what Selah means. It means pause, stop, and listen. Listen for the music. See, there is a music that's playing behind the scenes of your life. There's a song that you will never hear in the busyness and in the worry and in the stress and in the loneliness and in the anger and in the questioning that you will never hear unless you pause and listen for it. So, my friends, stop talking about what you're going through. Stop worrying, stop bemoaning, stop being afraid, and listen for the music of God. Now, this word Selah is used in all kinds of different places in the book of Psalms. Sometimes it's used following a particularly great call to worship. Sometimes this word say Selah is used after a gruesome passage of fear and doubts and trouble. You know, that tells me that no matter what you're going through in life, it's always a good time to take a Selah. It's always a good time to pause and listen for the music. You know, I believe that there are times in life, more often than we would like to admit, when God says, girl, hit pause. Would you just stop? Would you just stop and listen for my music? You know, because we can't do the whole book of Psalms, obviously, it would take us like 7 years to do it. I debated how to teach it to you, and this is what I'm going to do. Every week, I'm going to teach you one of my favorite chapters in the Bible. Something's meant a lot to me in my walk with the Lord. And then we're also going to study a chapter that's rich in that word, Selah. So tonight, let's start with a chapter in the Bible that has just meant so much to me in my Christian walk. When I was in the fifth grade, my Sunday school teacher had the fifth and sixth graders memorize the entire chapter one of Psalms. And the reason she had us do that is because when she was in the fifth grade, her Sunday school teacher required it of them as well. Now, my Sunday school teacher just happened to be my mother. Okay, I'll just come clean with you and tell you that. And so I think that knowing me and the girl I was growing up to be, my mother thought Carol needs someone. She's got to memorize this psalm because otherwise we are headed for trouble in the teenage years. And so we memorized Psalm 1, and I cannot tell you the times when I've been at a crossroads in my life when the Holy Spirit has brought me back to this chapter, and it's been a guiding light, it's been a lamp unto my feet. So Psalm chapter 1, verse 1. Now listen, in the book of Psalms, when it says the word man, it's talking about humanity, okay? And because this is a woman's Bible study, it's okay for us to say, you know, for Psalm 1 says, how blessed is the man. It's okay for us to say, how blessed is the woman. Because the Holy Spirit was talking about both of us, right? Right. I'm not changing the gender of God, okay? Got it? I would never do that. I revere him too much. I'm in awe of him too much. But it's okay for us to put us in these scriptures that are pointing at humanity. So, how blessed is the woman who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the path of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers. Now, this is a conundrum to me. This is a head-scratcher to me. How interesting that the book of worship, the book of Psalms, starts talking about me and you. It's like the Holy Spirit has our number. Are you kidding me? The Holy Spirit knew that we were going to have some struggles this side of heaven. And so the Holy Spirit started this book from the get-go with addressing real-life issues in our lives. How blessed is the woman who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the path of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers. So this psalm, Psalm 1, is a psalm of instruction. We need to be taught. Listen, I believe you can teach an old dog new tricks. I really do. And so some of us old dogs, we're going to learn some new tricks tonight. We're going to be instructed how to live in a place of blessing. Who wouldn't want that? Who wouldn't want to live a blessed life, an abundant life? It's free, totally free for the taking. But it's going to cost you something. It's going to cost you a lot. This psalmist is about to tell you how to live the life that you have always dreamt about. Anybody can live in this place of blessing. Anybody, as long as they obey the advice of God. Now, this verse tells us that there is a particular kind of blessing that God has for a particular type of person. Now, let me just reassure you, God loves you no matter what life choices you've made. He is head over heels in love with you. He loves you no matter what you've done or haven't said, what you've spent or haven't spent, what you've eaten or haven't eaten. He loves you. He's crazy head over heels in love with you. God forgives you no matter what you have done. His grace is abundant and you can't stop it. But there is a blessing for a particular group of people. How blessed is that woman who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked? Now, I love this phrase, how blessed, because what the psalmist is saying, there is no way to measure the blessing. You can't wrap a measuring tape around it. You can't put it on a scale. You can't measure how fast it travels. There is no way to measure the blessing that God has for a particular type of person. And this word blessed, how blessed, is in the plural form. That means it's more than one. More than one particular blessing for this particular person. This word blessing is the Hebrew word esher, and it has three levels of meaning. The first meaning is happy or prosperous. I'm in. How about you? I'm in. I want to be happy. I want to be prosperous. That sounds good to me. We're going to talk a little bit more later in the study about what that word prosperous actually means. And if that's all that how blessed meant, I'll do it. But that's not all it means. The second level of meaning for this Hebrew word esher is to go straight, to go in the right direction. Oh, there's the cost. To go straight, to go in the right direction. There's a blessing for people who live a certain way, who walk a certain way. Now, the third level of meaning is this, to lead or to guide. Oh, that's even better. Part of the blessing on your life is that you're going to lead other people. You're going to guide other people. Other people are going to be thinking, I wonder what she would do in this situation. I wonder what decision she would make. Because by the very power of your life, you will be a leader. So this esher means if you'll take the advice of the Bible, you'll be happy and even prosperous. We're going to talk about what prosperous means later. If you take the advice of the Bible, you'll go in the right direction and your life will lead and guide others. So who is this extraordinary person that gets to do all of those things? Well, this verse says, how blessed is that man or that woman? It's not just any man or any woman. It's emphatic. That man or that woman. It's one among a thousand who's willing to live a certain way, who's willing to pay a certain price. So the first two verses of the first chapter of Psalms clearly and vividly explain how to live a life of unmatched blessing. It tells you what you should do and what you should not do. Let me tell you something about the Bible. The Bible holds every answer to every life test you will ever face. It does. You know, you're going to have tests in life. If Jesus had tests, I think you probably will too. But the tests are all open book. And it's not cheating to open the book and figure out what to do. And if I were you, I wouldn't take one test without opening the book and seeing what the Bible says to do in any situation in life. So, that woman or that man who's going to receive a blessing, an enormous blessing, an abundance of blessings that's unable to be contained, she does not walk in the counsel of the wicked. Now, this word walk means to live or to follow a certain manner of life. The best way I can describe it to you is this. This word walk is used to describe what habitat we live in. A boat lives on an ocean, okay? A camel, his habitat is the desert. It's the climate or the habitat that you live in. And God is saying to his children, listen, I want you to live a blessed life. I want you to be happy and prosperous. I want you to go the right way. I want you to lead others. And the way that you're going to do that is by strategically choosing the atmosphere of your life, by walking in a certain way. So what habitat have you chosen? What environment are you living in? Now, I'm going to make this practical. You know, probably, if I were a betting woman, which I am not, but if I were, I would probably bet that most of you don't have a problem with, like, the big sins. You know, know, the big ones. Maybe some of you do, and that's okay. Jesus loves you. But most of us have a problem with hard attitudes. Getting way too angry and frustrated way too easily. Listening to the wrong voices. Because I can read women's minds. You know I can. You know that's a joke, right? I know that women tend to fantasize. I've been talking to a woman, you don't know this woman. She lives thousands of miles away. And at 60 years old, she still is thinking about her 16-year-old boyfriend. See? You know, you're challenged and life might be overspending or overeating. I have found that I have to be very, very careful what I listen to on TV. Whose voice I choose to listen to. I have found that as a woman of God who's trying to pay the price to live a godly life, that I have to be very, very careful about what I read. Can I just be vulnerable with you for a minute? I know you love when I'm vulnerable, when I tell on myself. But I travel a lot, and when I travel, I used to, past tense, don't do it anymore. There was the one time I would buy People magazine. Okay, I couldn't help myself, okay? I'm on an airplane, I don't know anybody, and there is Princess Diana on the cover, okay? And so it'd be the one time I'd spend the exorbitant cost of whatever it was, and I'd read it on the airplane and I'd leave it there. I can't do it anymore. Because People magazine has changed. It's nasty. It's not edifying. And it doesn't fill me with the right thing. So I don't know what gets to you, but as a believer in Jesus Christ, I must not take the advice or listen to human wisdom of people who are against God. Because it says in the counsel of the wicked, that word wicked means hostile to God, against God, belligerent to the kingdom. Okay, I've confessed about People magazine, and the Holy Spirit's talking to some of you. This might include politicians. Not every politician, okay? I'm not making a political statement. I'm just saying. It might include politicians or entertainers. Yes, it will include entertainers. Authors, media people. Who does your list include? Who are hostile to the things of God? It might include conversations in which you've participated. It might include parties that you've gone to. Now listen, we all cross paths, and we're supposed to cross paths with people who are hostile to God, aren't we? That's part of our calling as believers. But this is the deal. You're supposed to rub off on them. They're not supposed to rub off on you. Got it? This verse says, don't build a life in that spot. Don't choose that kind of environment to live in. Don't take their advice. How blessed is the woman who does not stand in the path of sinners. So first it says don't walk, and then it says don't stand. Don't stand in the path of sinners. This means to stay there, to tarry. Don't go where they're going. Don't go on the same pathway they're going on. Don't journey through life with those who don't know Jesus Christ. Yes, she'll rub shoulders. I want you to. I want you to rub shoulders. I remember one time when we were having a Christmas gala one year, and some of the women came to me and said, Carol, there's no way for me to invite. I don't have any unsafe friends. I said, sisters, you better go make some unsafe friends. You better enlarge your sphere of influence. But you should be rubbing off on them. How blessed is that woman who does not sit in the seat of scoffers? So first we were walking, then we were standing, then we sat down. Do you see the progression there? That if you walk, you'll probably stand. And if you stand, you'll probably sit. And sitting in the seat of scoffers is not a good idea. This word sit means to dwell, to have one's abode, or to marry. What ideology, what mindset, what attitudes from our culture have you married? Have you become one with? Because, listen, I try very hard not to point my finger at you because that means four are pointing back at me. And I'm aware of that. But we all, this is a night of self-examination and the price that we're being called to pay. We're not supposed to sit in the seat of scoffers. That word scoffers actually means to speak a foreign language. It means people who ridicule or mock godly wisdom. So, my friends, don't make yourself at home with people who mock your faith. You can love them. You can pray for them. You can love the socks off of them. You can encourage them till you're driving them crazy. But don't listen to them. Don't. Make sure that you live at a different address. 1 Corinthians 3:19 says, "For the wisdom of this world is foolishness." It's utter foolishness before God. You know, now when I, being the mother of five, when I would instruct my children to do something, by implication, they would also know that there was something they should not do. Conversely, if I would say to them, "Don't do that," they would pick up between the lines, "Oh, Mama wants me to do that." So if I would say to them, "Don't go to bed until your homework is done," they would know, "I have to do my homework before I go to bed." Did you get that? Did that make sense? If I would say to my kids, "Don't eat too much sugar," they would know that I was also saying, "Do eat healthy things. That's your freedom. That's what Mama wants me to do." If I would say to my sweet, darling teenagers, "Don't roll your eyes at me, I'm your mother," they would know I have to be respectful to my mom. Do you see what I'm saying? That what for every don't do this, there's a positive implication. And so it is with what we have just studied. We have been told what not to do, but it also implies what we should indeed do. So first of all, we were told, don't walk with those who are opposed to God. Where should we walk? If I don't get to walk there, where do I walk? Oh, I'm so glad you asked. Psalm 26:11 says, "But as for me, I shall walk in my integrity." That's where I'm going to walk. I'm going to be a woman of integrity. My word is going to be my bond. What I say I'm going to do. And I'm going to stay true to the gospel message and to the kingdom of God. The second thing we learned was, don't stand with those who are opposed to God. Well, then where should I stand? Again, thank you for asking. Psalm 22, 23 says this, "You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, glorify him and stand in awe of him." So where should you stand? Every day of your life, stand in awe of God and of what he's done for you. And then finally, we've learned not to sit with scoffers. Don't make yourself at home with those who are opposed to God. So where should I sit? Well, great question, sisters. Psalm 110 verse 1 says, "Sit at my right hand." Sit with the Father. Sit with Jesus Christ, the Son. Now, this might have been a harsh way to start a Bible study called Selah, but let me just tell you this. Listen. Being a Christian, living as a Christian, is not a list of rights and wrong, do's and don'ts. I promise it's not. But you know what being a Christian is? It's a glorious yes. It's a glorious and eternal and perpetual yes that we say to the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords, and nothing can distract us from saying yes to him. Nothing can embarrass us from saying yes to him. We will never say no to him, but we will live our lives in harmony with him and in who he has called us to be. Okay, if you want this enormous blessing in your life, is there anything else you should do? Yes. Psalm chapter 1, verse 2. "But her delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law she meditates day and night." Wow! Her delight is in the Bible. And it's all you can think about. You're so captivated by it. It's all you eat, sleep, and drink the Bible. So let me ask you a question. What delights you? This word delights, it means what brings you pleasure. What makes your adrenaline rush? What can't you wait to do on any given day of your life? Y'all know I'm a Christmasaholic, and when they started playing tonight, it's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. I almost jumped out of my seat. I thought, I am in the right place. These women love Christmas. What delights you? As you know, it's my grandkids. For some of you, it might be your career. You love your career. You can't believe you get to go to this place of work every day. For some of you, it's travel. You're planning the next trip before the last one has ended. For some of you, I'm just saying, I think for some of you, it's exercise. Okay, some of you just love to exercise. Monica, did you know that your Monica's toenails are all black and blue? Because she loves to exercise so much. That's my girl back there. What delights you? Chocolate, new clothes, a clean house, your marriage. This is what I want to tell you about the word delight. Whatever delights you also motivates you. Isn't that true? Whatever you're delighted by motivates you. We're motivated, we're moved to action by the things that delight us. Another thing about the things that delight us is we pursue them. We'll push other things out of the way to get to our delight, won't we? We value the things that delight us. We make decisions based upon the things that delight us. Should I have milk chocolate or dark chocolate? Oh, I think I'll have both. Thank you very much. You know, another thing about the things that delight us is we talk about those things. I can spend 5 minutes with you and know a whole lot about your life. A couple Sundays ago, I met Lisa out in the parking lot. I hadn't seen her in years, and all she could talk about was her kids. And I thought, I like her. She loves her kids. It's what delights her. What delights you? We talk about the things that delight us. We make time for the things that delight us. We spend money on the things that delight us. You know what? Craig and I have the greatest marriage. We really do. And he never says to me, honey, you haven't cooked in 3 months. That delight us because we count as precious the things that delight us. So if you want to be blessed by God, who is your provider and your healer and your father and your peace and your wisdom and your creator and your best friend, then you'll make the decision tonight that you're going to be delighted by the word of God. You know, in my battle with cancer, I had to be on some horrible drugs. And I was losing the use of my arms and legs because of the drugs that the oncologist had put me on. And I was on them for about 5 or 6 months. And they tried different forms, different types of the drugs. And I went and I said to him, I'm done. I'm done with the drugs. And he said, you are? Now, okay, so this is a very, like, you feel like you're in the president's office, okay? When you go see Dr. Sonny Waller, right, Elaine? You just don't even want to speak. You're shaking because you so respect him. But I said, I'm done. And he said, well, okay, if you are done with the drugs, then this is what you'll do. And he talked to me about changing my lifestyle, about no more chemicals on my skin, change the way I eat, no more sugar, no more soy. And he's going down the list, no more processed food, no more white rice, no more white bread, no more, no more, no more, no more. You know, and his nurse is looking at me, and she said, okay, Carol, let me tell you something. If you can only make one change in your life, change the meat that you eat. She said, eat all organic, free-range meat that hasn't been touched by chemicals. Now, I've made more changes than that, but let me tell you this, sisters. If you're only going to make one change in your life, read the Bible. Delight yourself in the word of God. The blessing that will come upon your life is enormous just by this one simple discipline. And in his law, she meditates day and night. Before you fall asleep, recite well-loved verses, but give the Holy Spirit something to work with. Read your Bible during the day so that when you fall asleep at night, you've got a verse to think about, right? When you wake up in the morning, rather than be stressed out by your list of things to do, think about the Bible day and night. The Word of God makes every day a great day. It does. The Word of God makes every day a great day. Psalm 1, verse 3. We really are almost done. We haven't got very far, but we really are. And this person, this particular person that has obeyed verses 1 and 2 will be like a tree firmly planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season and its leaf does not wither. And whatever she does, she prospers. So if you'll do those things, you're going to be like a tree whose roots go deep. And the storms of life are going to come, and they will. But it's not going to touch you, because you are walking in the right direction, because you're leading others, because you're delighted in the Word of God. And when a dry season blows through your life, and it will, you're going to have desert conditions someday. And when that comes, your leaf is not going to wither, because you're like a tree planted by the streams of living water, and you will prosper. And now, I want to talk about prosperity, because sometimes in the body of Christ, prosperity gets a bad rap. And it shouldn't, because it's a Bible word, okay? If you have a problem with the word prosperity, take it up with the Holy Spirit. But let me tell you what it means. It means more than money. Part of it is financial blessing, okay? But it also means you're going to prosper in your marriage. If you will delight in the Word of God, all of a sudden you're going to say, I was sweet to my husband when he burped at me. What happened? The Bible happened to you. All of a sudden you're going to realize, I didn't use my credit card this month. What happened to me? The Bible happened to you. All of a sudden when your mother starts criticizing you and you're just going to say, Mama, I love you so much. Thank you for that good advice. And you're going to say, what happened to me? The Bible happened to you. You're going to prosper in your personal life, in your parenting. You'll have wisdom that others don't have. That's Bible prosperity. You'll have peace in stormy situations. That's Bible prosperity. You'll be able to love difficult people. That's Bible prosperity. I want that life. And you get it by following the principles, by paying the price of Psalm chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, verses 4 and 5. The wicked are not so. They're like the chaff which the wind drives away. Least little breeze blows them away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment. They're going to fall. Nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. God's got his eye on you. He knows what you're going through. He knows what you're doing. And now, just in closing, I promise this is going to be fast. Our Selah verses for the week are found in Psalm 3. Psalm chapter 3. The word Selah is used three times in this one short psalm. Oh Lord, how my adversaries have increased. Many are rising up against me. Many are saying of my soul, there's no deliverance for him in God. How many of you are dealing with people problems right now? With difficult, cantankerous, fractious people. Okay. That's what the psalmist is talking about. He's talking about those people who are like fingernails on the chalkboard of life. And after the psalmist complains about these difficult people in his life, then he says, Selah. This is a good time to stop and listen for the music of God. When you're dealing with a difficult person, when you're in an uncomfortable situation with people, when you feel like a failure, when there's no easy way out of the mess you've made in a relationship, Selah. Pause and listen for the music of God. And verse 3 says, but you, O Lord, are a shield about me, my glory and the one who lifts my head. Are you kidding me? The psalmist has gone from saying, there's no deliverance for him in God. He's panicking. Selah. Oh, but you, O Lord, you're a shield about me. Do you see how that changed everything for the psalmist? Suddenly, a completely different perspective. Pausing and listening for the music of God changes the way you look at difficult people. And then, the psalmist says, I was crying to the Lord with my voice, and he answered me from his holy mountain. Selah. When you go to God, when you cry out to God in prayer, expect him to listen to you and to answer. Pause and listen. Listen, when you're having your prayer time, don't do all the talking, okay? Have you ever been with a friend who does all the talking? And you think, does she have an off switch? Like, remember Chad and Kathy, you'd pull her string and she'd keep talking? Remember that? You know, I want to rip that string right out of that doll's body. then pause and listen for the music of God. Psalm 3:5. I lay down and slept. Oh, do you see what Selah does for you? I lay down and slept. I awoke, for the Lord sustains me. I will not be afraid of 10,000s of people. The psalmist is saying, bring it. Bring it, difficult people. Bring it. I dare you. Because I am listening for the music of God in my life, who have set themselves round about me. Arise, O Lord, save me, O my God, for you have smitten all my enemies on the cheek. You have shattered the teeth of the wicked. Okay, last verse. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Your blessing be upon your people, Selah. Isn't that interesting that we started out with blessing tonight or ending with blessing? Isn't that interesting? Just the way it sort of worked out. You're blessed when you have said the glorious yes to Jesus. Is there a price to pay? Absolutely. But is the price worth it? Every day of my life. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we love you so much. Father, thank you for your presence in this room tonight. Father, I thank you for every person here, every man and woman who came. Father, I pray that this word will go deep and that it will accomplish the purpose for which you set it forth. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I think that Kim and Lynn are going to close us. But are you going to say